We are in 2 Chronicles chapter 21 and a message titled Dysfunctional Family. I don't know if there's anybody today that didn't grow up in somewhat of a dysfunctional family. You know, just trying to explain to my kids who their grandparents are is ridiculous in my household. You know, I mean, it's like we have grandparents that are grandparents, and we have grandparents that are not really grandparents, but like, you know, I have my stepdad and his wife, which isn't married. This guy's not even married to my mom anymore, Jeff. But then we have my mom and her husband, and then we have my dad and his wife, and then my wife has her dad and his wife and her mom and her husband, and then, you know, like grandpas that are no longer grandpas anymore, and it's just so confusing. You know, I remember my son saying one time, it's like, how come he's not my grandpa anymore? It's like, this is the way that life is, you know, it's so sad. But, you know, every one of us, you know, faces that in our lives. We go through these difficulties and, you know, just seeing people come and go in our lives. And yet, you know, I don't know that any of us, and hopefully none of us, have a dysfunctional family quite as dysfunctional as this family. And we're going to be looking at a family today that really, really is messed up. And maybe you've experienced this. Maybe you have a pretty normal household. Your parents were good and everything was great, but then you actually married into a dysfunctional family. And that family you married into has all kinds of turmoil and drama and problems associated with it. Well, as we've been looking at the southern kingdoms of Judah, we've seen Asa, who was a good king, but, you know, at the end of his life had a little bit of a difficulty and didn't really inquire of the Lord when he should have. He ended up hiring the Syrians to come against the northern kingdom, and you know, God rebuked him for it and said, hey, you know, you shouldn't have done that. And so his response to that was really bad. You know, as far as a believer's response goes, it was a bad response. He put the prophet in jail, in prison, and then he abused some of the people. And that was just the way that he responded to that. And then later on in life, after he had gone through the difficulty of having a disease in his feet, he didn't and he wouldn't seek the Lord. And so he ended up seeking the physicians instead and ended up dying of that. And then his son Jehoshaphat was born. Now, Jehoshaphat was a great king. And he followed the Lord with all of his heart, and he did all the right things, and, you know, everything he should be doing, he did, except his problem was that he allied himself with the king of Israel, which was Ahab, and not just allied himself, but married his son to Athaliah, the daughter of Ahab. And so joining him in marriage and then going up and hanging out with him and going into battle with him, which almost cost him his life and did cost Ahab his life, barely escaped with his life. And then later on in his life, as we ended up last time, we saw that he had made an alliance with or built some ships with the king of Israel, Ahab's son, and ended up, you know, having the ships wrecked and everything was lost. And so just a guy who just didn't have any discernment when it came to making relationships. But this ends up being a worse problem than Jehoshaphat probably ever could have expected it to be, you know, as he marries his son off to this woman, Athaliah. And it says in verse 1, it says, and Jehoshaphat rested, 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 1, and Jehoshaphat rested with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. Then Jehoram, his son, reigned in his place. Now, you'll remember, this gets confusing, and you're going to see later on another Jehoram. Don't be confused by that. When we were in 1 Kings, we remember there was two Jehorams, and sometimes they'd call one Joram and the other one Jehoram. You guys remember that? Some of you might remember that. So we're going to see another Jehoram later, or Joram later. But during this time, Ahab had his son or his daughter marry this man, Jehoram. And so this is Ahab's son-in-law married to his daughters, Athaliah, who is a real piece of work, as we're going to see. Verse 2, it said, and he had brothers, the sons of Jehoshaphat, Azariah, Jehiel, Zechariah, Azaruhu, Michael and Shephatiah. All these were sons of Jehoshaphat, king of Israel. Their father gave them great gifts of silver and gold and precious things and fortified cities in Judah, but he gave the kingdom to Jehoram because he was the firstborn. And so what we see here is that we see Jehoshaphat, when he had these sons, he entrusted them all with a lot. He gave them cities to rule over. He gave them gold and silver, money to manage. And it would seem that he was a very orderly king. And you remember that he would send the teachers of the law through all the cities, and they would teach the word of God to people. And so it was very important to Jehoshaphat that everybody knew the Lord, that everybody was exposed to the teaching of the word. And so he'd send these teachers and the priests out. And then he also set up justices and these people who would go to each city and bring justice. You know, they were judges to be able to deal with the matters that, you know, the problems that people were having, and to get justice for the people when somebody had wronged them or when there was some case that needed to be heard. And so Jehoshaphat was very orderly, and putting his sons in these areas were helping to keep that order. And so every single one of these sons could easily have been a godly example, a godly king for the people. But because his oldest son, Jehoram, was the oldest, and the oldest usually was the one who, you know, I think we all have a soft spot for our oldest, don't we? I mean, it's your first one, you have great ambitions for that child, you know, you think this is going to be wonderful, you know, they're going to be the perfect child, you know, we just have these great ambitions for our oldest child. Don't always work out so good. But it says, verse 4, now when Jehoram was established over the kingdom of his father, he strengthened himself and killed all his brothers with a sword, and also others of the princes of Israel. Nice way to start your reign. Shows where his influence is coming from. It's not coming from Jehoshaphat. And this was not the way that they did things in the southern kingdom. This isn't the way that David and Solomon or any of these guys would act when it came to treating one another. And here's a guy who gets the kingdom, and his mother, you know, would, or his wife rather, would have him do this. And she's actually the daughter, if you remember, Ahab's wife was Jezebel. And Jezebel pretty much ran the country of the northern kingdom. She told Ahab what to do. You remember, she was the spiritual leader. She was the leader of the home. And Ahab pretty much did whatever Jezebel wanted. And Athaliah is not going to have it any different. She's going to have it the same way. And so verse 5, it says, Jehoram was 32 years old when he became king. And he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. And he walked in the ways of the kings of Israel, just as the house of Ahab had done. For he had the daughter of Ahab as wife, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord. Now, this is a guy who was raised in the Lord. He was strong, no doubt, as he grew up, you know, raised. If it's kind of like a kid today, it's raised in the church, you know, and he's been taught everything that he's supposed to know to follow the Lord and to know the Lord. I mean, this is something that Jehoshaphat didn't take for granted. It was something that Jehoshaphat made sure that his kids knew. But Jehoshaphat voluntarily brought in this Athaliah, trying to make peace with the northern kingdom, thinking it was going to be a good idea. But just as the word tells us, that bad company corrupts good morals, doesn't it? Don't ever think, well, he may not know the Lord, but I'll convert him. Or she doesn't know the Lord, but I'll take her to church. I'll work that out. It might work out. I've seen cases, you know, I have a good friend whose girlfriend was not Christian at all, and he brought her to church, and she ended up getting saved, and she actually is a very godly person. And then I've seen 10 other cases where that didn't work out that way. And so it's possible that you can save them. But I've seen more cases where somebody who is a Christian finds themselves in a relationship with somebody who's not a Christian, and they end up walking away from the Lord themselves. You know, it's easier when you're up on a chair for somebody to pull you off the chair than for you to pull them up onto the chair, right? It's easier to pull somebody down than it is to pull them up. And so this is the situation here. And of course, the Bible warns us of this. In 2 Corinthians 6:14, Paul tells the Corinthians, "Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are all the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate." That word there means holy, says the Lord. "And do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty." What does it mean to be unequally yoked with a non-believer? It doesn't mean you can't be friends with a non-believer. It doesn't mean that you can't, hang out in places where non-believers hung out. You see, Jesus was a friend of sinners, right? And so it's not that we have to say, we can't, hang out with people that aren't believers or work, where people are non-believers. It's not what it's saying at all. What it's saying is don't yoke yourself in any type of agreement or partnership where you're responsible for the other person's actions with somebody who's a non-believer. And when we do that, we put ourselves in danger. Now, some of you are probably thinking, well, didn't you marry somebody who was Mormon? I married somebody who was Mormon, but when I did take her out on a date. We went on a date, and I found out she was Mormon, and then I wouldn't take her on any dates anymore. And I separated myself from her, because that's when I found out she wasn't a Christian. And so I separated myself from that situation, and it wasn't until she became a Christian, and I saw that she was serious about it, that I would open myself up to be in a relationship with her. And what's interesting is the guy who, between me and her, he was a Christian. He dated her, and he didn't have that moral fortitude. He was going to date her even though she was LDS, and she ended up, they ended up not getting together. But then the Lord brought me along, and, I think patience will pay off. God is, he's good, and he knows your needs. He knows he can do your life better than you can do your life. And we start dictating to God, hey, I want to be somebody be married to somebody who I just feel like is going to make me happy because I love that person. Just realize that when you find yourself unequally yoked with somebody who's not a believer, you find yourself in trouble. For Shannon, it was it was one of those things where she had to, go through those trials. And I'm glad, honestly, I'm glad that we weren't trying to date during that time, because she would argue with people, and they would say, hey, this is what the Bible says. And so she'd go to her bishop, and she'd get herself in trouble for asking questions. You can't ask questions. And she'd say, hey, why do we teach this if the Bible says this? And so it ended up being this huge drama and controversy. And eventually she realized, I have to set aside, and this is the interesting thing about this. I was just thinking about this the other day because, it's a very emotional thing. Her whole family was part of that. Her whole life was there. She had good memories. She had spiritual experiences, all this over here. And so she has all of her emotion on one side and then the truth on the other side. And what are you going to do with that? And so she had to look, am I going to believe the truth? Or am I going to follow my heart? Am I going to believe what the Bible says, or am I going to believe what my heart is telling me? That this is my family, and this is my childhood. She loved the Mormon church. She loved it. Absolutely. And ultimately she surrendered it to the Lord, and she said, I don't care what's true. I just want to go to heaven. And that's when the Lord revealed himself to her, and she was able to see that this is, it's okay to follow the Lord. But here we find this situation where here's two people, they're married, and they're two completely different religions. One's following the Lord, Baal. That's what Baal means, is Lord. And one is following Jehovah, the God of the Hebrews. One sacrifices children. The other one, you know, does what's right. And so you have these two completely different, diametrically opposed belief systems. And yet, it always comes down to the axiom. Happy wife, happy life. Hey, I'm just saying, you know. Mom ain't happy, nobody's happy, right? I mean, is anybody going to deny that? You guys all shaking your heads, but I mean, is it true or is it not true? He's going to either live with his wife and, you know, she's going to make his life miserable. And so he has to decide, and he doesn't choose the Lord. And that's often the problem, is that most people will not choose truth over emotion. You know, one author described it as your will is the rider and your emotion is the elephant. And you're riding an elephant. And if the elephant wants to go that direction, which way are you going to go? It's going to go wherever it wants to go, right? And the will only has so much control over the elephant, you know. And so when it comes to it, we have to decide, which one are we going to follow? Are we going to follow what's true, or are we going to follow what our emotions are telling us? Because the heart is deceitful and wicked above all things. You know, it's interesting because some religions will even say, you know, you need to follow your heart. You need to have a burning in your bosom to know that it's true, a feeling. And yet the Bible is not a feeling. Faith is not a feeling. It's to believe in what you know to be absolutely fact. You know, and so we have that fact to stand on. And you have to decide between two. You can't waffle between two opinions because you feel one way or another way. We have to be established in the facts. And then the feelings will follow if we'll follow the facts. Verse 7, he says, yet the Lord would not destroy the house of David. What does that tell you about how the Lord felt about this guy? The Lord would not destroy the house of David because of the covenant he had made with David. And since he had promised to give a lamp to him and his sons forever. So now this line is going to turn into a thread as we're going to go through this. And that light is going to become so dim that it's almost like everybody believed it went completely out. You know, that's how bad things are going to get. But God is always faithful. And that's what we have to remember. God is always faithful to complete what he says he's going to do. Verse 8, it says, in his days, Edom revolted against Judah's authority and made a king over themselves. So they were a vassal kingdom. Israel had brought them under tribute. They didn't have a king in Edom at the time. And now there's a new king in Israel. And that's oftentimes what would happen when there's a change of the guard in a kingdom. Then everybody who's kind of under the authority of that king would say, hey, do we have an opportunity here with the change of a king to get out from underneath this bondage? So they appointed themselves a king, which Israel had not allowed them to do, and now they're going to try to get out of that. And it says, so Jehoram went out with his officers and all the chariots with him, and he rose by night and attacked the Edomites who had surrounded him and the captains of the chariots. And thus, Edom has been in revolt against Judah's authority to this day. At that time, Libnah revolted against his rule because he had forsaken the Lord, God of his fathers. And so it gives us a reason. This is why these people revolted. It wasn't because necessarily they saw that he was weak. It was the right opportunity, sure, but it was because he'd forsaken the Lord. And, you know, when somebody's, when Jehoshaphat's in the kingdom, or when Asa's in the kingdom, and they're ruling over these nations that are around them. God's given them peace all around them, and people are bringing tribute to them, which helps them. You know, basically, we're going to protect you with our military. You're going to, you know, give us goods and services, and we're going to be over you. You know, it wasn't necessarily a bad arrangement. But now that here's a king who's falling away from the Lord, and his life is starting to fall apart. I don't know if you realize that, but that's exactly what happens. You know, it's not saying that a Christian's life is easy, And it's not saying that you're not going to go through trials or temptations or things are going to seem to go wrong. But there is a certain protection being underneath the Lord. Have you noticed that? I mean, he keeps him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him because he trusts in him. God gives us peace when we're following him. But when we decide we're not going to follow him, it's amazing to me that when we kind of go off track and we start to do things we're not supposed to be doing and we're kind of following our own plan, that the things around us, even if they seem to be going good, don't bring us any peace. And we could be going through trials as a Christian and we have more peace than we don't than we do if we're not following the Lord. And so it's just kind of an interesting thing. You know, this is what this revolt is causing. He talks about up until this day, even to this day, and this was written during the time probably of Ezra. You know, we've been talking about Nehemiah, so this is quite a bit later that these things are recorded here. And the reason is this book, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, were written for the post-exilic Jews. Now, this will kind of culminate and climax to the Babylonians coming in and taking Judah into captivity. You remember that, right? And so what happened was, after the Babylonian captivity, Ezra and some of the other scribes got together, they compiled all the stories, they pulled together the books of Kings, they got all the records that they could get, and they wrote the Chronicles. And the whole idea of 1st and 2nd Chronicles was to remind the Jews, as they go back into the Promised Land, these are the things we're supposed to do, and this is what we need to learn from those things. Because as we all know, if we don't learn from history, we're doomed to repeat it, right? If you don't look, and it's a funny thing. There's nothing new under the sun. You watch, you know, countries and rulers, and they make these same mistakes over and over and over again because they don't realize it's a bad idea. I'm looking at just our country today, you know, and it's funny, you know, that we have all these people who are socialists who are trying to take over our country. I just realized this the other day. You know, I just kind of had an epiphany the other day. Do you realize that our whole country has been fed this idea that we need to reduce our carbon footprint and live in a tiny house, and we need to stop eating meat, we need to go vegan, because that's what everybody should be doing, because cows create carbon gases that destroy the ozone layer and everything else, and it's causing climate change, because every time a cow farts, it ruins the ozone layer. I'm not kidding, but this is this whole generation is coming up behind me. They believe all this stuff. And basically what it comes down to, and here, let me just pull the veil back for you. What they're being told is, you are a peasant, you need to live in a peasant house, and you're not allowed to eat meat because you're not good enough. And only the people who live in the big houses are going to be able to eat meat and live in a big house because they're better, and you're going to be a peasant. You know, basically, we've just completely conditioned our entire society through global warming or whatever, climate change, to say, hey, you just need to live like a peasant and, you know, buy this lie that there's, you know, that capitalism is evil and all this stuff. It's amazing. I don't know what got me onto that. That was total soapbox. Sorry. But if we don't learn from history, we're doomed to repeat it. I mean, you want that type of existence? Just look at what happened in Russia and in China and all these other places that bought into socialism and communism and what the result of that is. Look at Argentina. Look at all these countries that are socialists right now. And the people are starving and revolting. Why? Because you need people to actually work, you know? I mean, don't you? I was refreshed by this millennial girl. She went to Uganda. It was at the Workers' Worship Conference. She went to Uganda, and she was convinced that she needed to go and find social injustices, you know, that she needed to go see where women were being oppressed and, you know, be a journalist and go to these places and see how she could help. And so she went there, and she believed a lot of this stuff. She believed capitalism was evil. She believed, you know, all these different things. And she went there, and she decided, I need to start a nonprofit. So she started looking into nonprofit, and then she realized how evil that was. Just get the rich Americans to give me money so that I can hand it off to these poor African people, and they can be ever so grateful for the nice white people who bring us money so that we don't have to do anything. And she just saw the damage that was doing to them. And she's like, you know, I actually think I probably need to start a business for these people. And so she started a company, got them working, earning their way into college, giving them jobs so that when they get out of college, they can actually do something productive, and changed an entire village. You know, somebody who thought, oh, well, she just believed the lie that all the colleges are teaching the kids today, you know, capitalism is evil, socialism is good. And she realized, you know, looking at it firsthand, the truth of the matter. You know, so if we don't know the history, we're doomed to repeat it. And that's basically what's happening here. We're just seeing this whole thing laid out so that when the post-exilic Jews read this story, they can say, okay, that's what happens when a king goes bad. That's what happens when a nation follows evil. It's just going to bring harm upon them. That's probably the most political I've ever gotten. I just had these epiphanies. Anyway, so moving on, it says, verse 11, moreover, he made high places in the mountains of Judah and caused the inhabitants of Jerusalem to commit harlotry and led Judah astray. Again, 1 Corinthians 15:33, don't be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. Experts say that you are like the five people you hang out with the most. That's who you will become. You know, you just think about that. Take inventory of that. Okay, who am I hanging out with? I hang out with my kids mostly. Oh, no. Just kidding. No, it's not talking about that. You know, the people who influence you, the people maybe you work with, or the people you spend time socially with, these are the people that are most like you. You look at five people closest to you, that's probably the type of person that you are. And you know, here's a guy who married into this very evil family. And so the number one person influencing him is just evil to the core. It says, verse 12, a letter came to him from Elijah the prophet. That'd be nice to get a letter from Elijah the prophet, wouldn't it? Maybe. I guess it depends on if you're a good guy or a bad guy. But here's a guy who's called to serve the northern kingdom, you know, the wicked kingdom that was never a good king in Israel, and called to serve during a time when they had the wickedest king that they had, which was Ahab. Now, this is something that I want you to think about. Here is this evil, evil king, and yet during the time when there was the most evil king to ever exist in the nation of Israel, God sends the most godly prophet to ever live. Isn't that interesting? I mean, God could have just said, I'm wiping this place out. They're not worth my time. I'm going to send all the good people down to the Judah where they at least have some good kings. I'm not going to even bother with this northern kingdom of Israel because they have a wicked king and everybody's doing idolatry. No, he sends the best prophet, the most intense prophet during the most darkest time, or during, that's the horrible language, English. Can't even speak tonight. During the worst time, during the most wicked king. And I love that because, you know, God is never asleep at the wheel. God's always working. God's always shining a light when there's darkness. And the darker the darkness, the brighter the light shines. You know, we can't get discouraged when we see things going the way that we don't want them to go. Or when we look at our nation and the lies that people are believing. We have to realize that God always has something going on. You know, we don't need to be discouraged by that. And yet, here, this wicked king rises. Elijah writes him a letter. And these are the only, you guys realize this, these are the only written words we have from Elijah the prophet in the entire Bible. This is the only place, and this is what he has to say. Thus says the Lord of your father David, because you have not walked in the ways of Jehoshaphat your father, in the ways of Asa the king of Judah, but have walked in the way of the kings of Israel, and have made Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to play the harlot like the harlotry of the house of Ahab, and also have killed your brothers like those of your father's household who were better than yourself. There's a good boosting your self-esteem. He's saying every single one of those guys, every single one of your brothers was better than you. He says, behold, the Lord will strike your people with serious affliction, your children, your wives, and all your possessions. I want you to take note of something here, and that is that God deals with corrupt leaders. When somebody's leading who is corrupt, whether it's a nation, whether it's a corporation, whether it's a church, God is going to deal with that person. And he has his purposes for them, and sometimes that's to bring judgment upon a nation or upon some people. But at the end of the day, God has a leader. He has placed a leader that is deserved, or he has put a good leader because he desires to change things. And that's something that we always have to, you know, kind of step back. You know, we think about our role, and in our government, we have amazing abilities to do things that they don't in a lot of other places. I mean, we can have a voice, we can write a letter when we don't agree with something, we can vote, we should do all those things as Christians because we have those privileges, those rights. I mean, people die for some of the rights that we have. A lot of people have died for the rights that we've been given as a nation. However, having said that, what's more important is that we, 2 Chronicles 7:14, humble ourselves and pray and turn from our wicked ways. And Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. It is important for us to be a part of a process, but we can't lose sight of our own responsibility personally. You know, and if I'm calling myself a Christian and I'm living a sinful life and all the Christians around me are just, you know, I'm boosted by them because hey, everybody's doing it. You know, everybody's acting like this. Everybody's watching those things. Everybody's, you know, it's just normal. If that's the way that I'm living, then I shouldn't expect that my vote's going to count for anything. Because the nation's going down the tubes. You realize that it says in the last days, men will be lovers of self. In other words, it's going to be a huge thing about self-esteem, and they're going to be telling everybody that's the most important thing is that you love yourself. That's what the Bible says. It's not just going to be in the world where that's expected, but he says that self-esteem is going to be a thing in the church, where men will be lovers of self, haters of good, boastful, proud. You know, all those things, that's when Paul describes those things to Timothy, he's not talking about the world, he's talking about the church. This is what the church is going to look like in the last days. And if you look at the church today and the things that are being, the popular books that are coming out and the things that they're pushing, you know, and it's interesting because that's such a pernicious lie. You're a good person. Because who's good? The Bible says no one's good, no, not one. And there's a good thing to be ashamed of yourself. You know, sometimes it is important for us to be ashamed of ourselves because we did something shameful. And just to think that everybody should be told that they should, you know, love themselves. Everybody loves themselves already. Nobody needs. You realize that the people who score highest on self-esteem are people in prison because they think they're the best thing that ever was out there. They're the ones that score the highest on self-esteem tests. You see, it's okay to feel good about good accomplishments. It's okay to feel good when you've done something good. But just to be told somebody you need to feel good about yourself no matter what, that's a lie. Because there's things that we should be ashamed of, and there's things that we need to repent of. And how can I tell somebody you are evil and you need a savior if everybody's been telling them, no, you're a good person, when they're not? You know, every single one of us, everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We all need a Savior. There is none good, no, not one. Good teacher, what works must we do to gain eternal life? They asked Jesus, and Jesus says, why do you call me good? There is no one good except one, that is God, right? And so just to think that this is even something that's okay within Christian circles, it is a very scary thing. It's a very scary thing. And we're living in that age where the church is pushing this. It's like there's self-esteem classes in the church. Now, I don't think it's any benefit to anybody to think poorly of themselves all the time either. I'm not saying that. But I think that we need to be very careful about what we're allowing people to esteem themselves concerning when it comes to the reality of who we are and what we need. You know, we need to find our esteem in the Lord and the value that he places on us and not a value that we've assigned to ourselves. And so that's, you know, that's the answer to that. But we as Christians need to make sure that we, as citizens of heaven first and citizens of a country second, that we are taking inventory of ourselves to turn from our wicked ways and to start to seek the Lord, because that's when he brings healing to a nation, when his people who are called by his name humble themselves and pray. And humility is the opposite of pride and the opposite of self-esteem, right? To humble ourselves and pray and turn from our wicked ways. And then he'll hear from heaven, he'll forgive our sins and heal our land. So important that we understand that. I'm not saying that we need to think poorly of ourselves necessarily, unless we should think poorly of ourselves because we need to repent. And so I just want to say that. I don't think that people should go around and say, I'm just a worm, you know, and get that mentality either. But the key is to stop thinking about yourself altogether, you know, start to put your focus on Jesus, because he's the true value. Okay, verse 15, and you will become very sick with a disease in your intestines until your entrails come out by reason of sickness day by day. That's a happy bit of news to receive from Elijah. By the way, your guts are going to come out, not just all at once, but day by day. There's a famous story in my family. I was told this when I was a kid, and I don't know if it's true. I was told it was, but basically, a friend of my grandfather had come home sick one day because he'd been drinking too much, and so he, in the dark, stumbled over to the sink and threw up in the sink, and he went and turned the light on. It felt a little bit much, and he went and turned the light on. He looked in the sink, and it was full of guts. And so his wife came home, and he was sitting on the floor looking kind of green. And she said, are you okay? And he says, you know, I threw up all my guts in the sink, but by the grace of God and a long-handled spoon, I was able to get them all back where they needed to be. And she said, honey, I gutted 3 chickens in that sink. And then up they came again. Oh, I know, you just ate too, and that's the good thing about that. You just ate chicken, in fact. I was asking about this, you know, I was reading this, you know, it says he's by sickness day by day. Notice what the Lord does. Verse 16, it says, moreover, the Lord stirred up against Jehoram the spirit of the Philistines and the Arabians, who were near the Ethiopians, and they came up unto Judah and invaded it and carried away all the possessions that were found in the king's house, and also his sons and his wives, so that there was not a son left to him except Jehoahaz, the youngest of his sons. Now, this should be a little bit of a relief to us in our current political situation, in our current nation. The idea that God is still in control. Here's this wicked king, and so what does God do? He stirs up this nation. He stirs up that nation. He starts to deal with this family. And I don't want to get all into that again, but, you know, we should vote, you know. I'm not saying that we shouldn't vote. I think that we all should be, as much as God tells us to, involved in the political process, but I also think that there's a lot to be said for praying and repenting and seeking and sharing the good news of Jesus. And so verse 18, it says, after all this, the Lord struck him and his intestines with an incurable disease. And you would think that this would cause him to repent, but it didn't. And this is verse 19. Then it happened in the course of time, after the end of 2 years, that his intestines came out because of his sickness. So he died in severe pain, and his people made no burning for him like the burning of his fathers. And so they didn't burn incense for him when he died. You know, his intestines just started coming out. And, you know, I asked the pastors, I said, hey, I have a question for a pastor. Anybody want to answer it? And Jason and Jeremiah are like, how about Mike? And I said, no, okay, here's the question. Serious. You guys can answer this question. It says that the intestines were going to come out. My question is, which end? Oh, I'm sorry. But they came out. So verse 20, he was 32 years old when he became king. He reigned in Jerusalem 8 years, and to no one's sorrow, notice that. How would you like to die with those words after your name? To no one's sorrow departed. However, they buried him in the city of David, but not in the tombs of the kings. This is how repulsive this guy was. 8 years. 8 years in office. You know, we always say those words. He could be 8 years in office, right? I don't think we've ever had a president this wicked. Not this wicked. It says, verse 1, then the inhabitants of Jerusalem made Ahaziah, his youngest son, king in his place, for the raiders who came with the Arabians into the camp had killed all the older sons. So Ahaziah, the son of Jehoram, king of Judah, reigned. Ahaziah was 42 years old when he became king, and he reigned 1 year in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Athaliah, the granddaughter of Omri. Okay, so we have a mistake here, right? Because he was 40 years old when he died, and his son started to reign when he was 42. 2 Kings 8:26 tells us that he was 22. So we know from that passage that he was actually 22. So why does it say 42 here? Probably a copyist error. I checked the Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Old Testament, and it said 22. So sometime after the 2nd century, somebody copying made the 4 instead of the 2, you know, there. But it's in all of our English Bibles. But 2 Kings 8:26 tells us it was 22 years old, and the Septuagint in this passage says 22. So somebody, yours says 22. Yeah, that's because what translation do you have? Okay. The extra special version. They just corrected the copyist error. Anyway, so verse 3, it says, he also walked in the ways of the house of Ahab, for his mother advised him to do wickedly. Okay, so God kills all of her kids except for this one. He kills her husband. He dies of this disease. I wonder if it wasn't similar to the disease that Herod had. Remember when Herod stood before the crowd and they said the voice of a god and not of a man, and he didn't give glory to God? He, in pride, you know, with self-esteem, he decided, you know, yeah, I deserve that praise. And immediately he was eaten of worms. Like, he fell down, and then his intestines bursted open with worms coming out. You know, that's what happened to him. Same thing happened to Antiochus Epiphanes. And you don't read that in the Bible. It alludes to him, and Daniel prophesies of Antiochus Epiphanes, but in the book of Maccabees, it talks about him, but it doesn't record this. And the book of Maccabees, of course, is apocryphal books that are only Catholic Bible, historical books. But in the Annals of the World, written by James Usher, and he is a great historian, he records that Antiochus Epiphanes actually died basically eaten of worms, and he realized, you know, God had told him that he was dying because of his revolt against his blasphemy and his revolt against the temple. And the guy was horrible. I'm not going to describe what he did, but it was awful. And so I wonder if it was similar to this. You know, he's eaten of worms, and his wife watches this happen. After he receives a letter from Elijah the prophet saying, this is what's going to go down, you would think that somebody seeing that letter and knowing the situation would realize this is not a good way to live. And yet she still instructs her son to live that same way. And it wouldn't cause him to repent. Verse 4 says, therefore, he did evil in the sight of the Lord, like the house of Ahab, for they were his counselors after the death of his father to his destruction. You know, this makes me, you know, question, where do I get my counsel from? You know, of course, is it Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sin, or stands in the path of sinners, or sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. And so, you know, to get counsel from ungodly things, and I just wonder, where do we get our counsel from? You know, it's amazing to me. You know, in those days, you had to actually go to somebody to get counsel, but today, you just have to look on Facebook. You know, I mean, you got ideas, and you got, you know, I mean, just like I was talking about today, you have voices telling you all kinds of things, how to live, how to, you know, what's the better things to do in life. You know, I mean, you just have it all day long from CBS and Fox and Facebook and Instagram and whatever. I mean, everybody's pushing everything on you and telling you what's right and what's wrong. You know, you listen to these political talk show things, and you're being told this is what's right and this is what's wrong and this is the way it is and this is the way it isn't. You know, and whether it's liberal or conservative, you know, is this where we're getting our mores? Is this where we're getting our philosophies for life? Are we getting our philosophies from the Word of God? And that's, I think that that's the problem for the most part in this society. Because a lot of voices out there are very bitter and very toxic. You know, whether the things that they're espousing are more true or less true, you know, it's amazing to me. You know, and we have a lot of things to listen to. And we could sit in just a couple hours and watch like 20 different videos from TED Talks to Facebook videos, you know, and some of them are funny, will make us laugh, you know, see if you can't cry when you're laughing at this video or something like that, to, you know, this is what's right and this is what's wrong. And you sit and watch those things, and all those things are influencing us. He was going to a wrong source, and he had to actually go up north to hear these people counsel him. But all we have to do is turn our TV on or look at our phone, and we have all kinds of ungodly things coming at us. And so, you know, when we think about, you know, counsel and where we're going to get counsel, we have to think about, am I getting this from the right source or the wrong source? Because it was to his demise that he listened to their counsel. And it's to our demise if we listen to the wrong voices. It's the Word of God that should guide our lives. In his law, he meditates day and night, Psalm 1 tells us, right? That's what's going to make him planted like a tree planted by the waters, who gives fruit in its season, who's going to prosper in all that he does. You know, this guy's getting ungodly counsel. It says, verse 5, he also followed their advice and went with Jehoram, the king of Ahab, king of Israel, to war against Hazael, the king of Syria, at Ramoth-Gilead, and the Syrians wounded Jehoram. Doesn't that sound familiar? Isn't this what Jehoshaphat did with Ahab? Went and fought at Ramoth-Gilead against the Syrians. And what happened? Ahab got wounded. And Jehoshaphat barely escaped with his life because he partnered with the northern Israel as well. I mean, again, if we don't know history, we're doomed to repeat it. On a side note, this is the moment that it was during that battle that some of the commanders were hanging out together, and one of the sons of the prophets sent by Elijah went and talked to him and said, hey, God wants to bring judgment against the house of Ahab. Go and tell this guy Jehu that he's going to bring that justice. And so Jehu came, ended up killing all these people, everybody who was left from Ahab. And that's what's going to be, that's going to be the end of this king. It says, verse 6, then he returned to Jezreel to recover from his wounds which he had received at Ramah. And this is Jehoram. So remember I told you it was Jehoram and Joram, same guy, northern kingdom, same name as Ahaziel, or what's his name? I get all these names mixed up. The current king, is his dad was also Jehoram, and now his uncle or whatever is Jehoram as well. But it says, verse 6, it says, then he returned to Jezreel to recover from the wounds which he had received in Ramah, and he fought against Hazael, king of, when he fought against Hazael, king of Syria, and Azariah, the son of Jehoram, so that's the guy, king of Judah, went down to see Joram, his uncle, the son of Ahab, in Jezreel, because he was sick. It's so nice of him to come and visit, huh? I mean, so this is the same type of thing, you know? Ahab got killed during one of these battles, and now he's wounded, and they were both involved. Verse 7, it says, his going to Jehoram was God's occasion for Ahaziah's downfall, for when he arrived, he went out with Jehoram against Jehu, the son of Nimshi, who the Lord had anointed to cut off the house of Ahab. And it happened when Jehu was executing judgment on the house of Ahab and found the princes of Judah and the sons of Ahaziah's brothers who served Ahaziah, that he killed them. So Jehu, this guy, we read about him in 2 Kings, but he, of course, drove furiously to the place where the guy was, killed him, went to Samaria, found Jezebel, had the eunuchs throw her down. She, you know, hit the ground, broke her neck, and he ran over a couple times with the chariots, and the dogs came and ate her up, and all that was left was her, was the palms of her hands and her feet or something like that. Disgusting. You know, I mean, this was God's judgment against this wicked family. And now here's this guy who is a son of Ahab as well, but also a son of Jehoshaphat, and he happens to be classic case of wrong place, wrong time. But God sees it as an occasion, as he's bringing judgment on the house of Ahab through Jehu, he sees it as an occasion to bring judgment on him as well. Verse 9, he's only been king for a year. It says, then he searched for Ahaziah, and they caught him. He was hiding in Samaria, and brought him to Jehu. When they had killed him, they buried him because they said, he is the son of Jehoshaphat who sought the Lord with all of his heart. So the house of Ahaziah had no one to assume power over the kingdom. So here's Ahaziah. He's in Samaria. They find him. They kill him. But notice what they did. They didn't just throw him out in the field for the dogs to eat him, because that was what was going to happen. The dogs would lick up the blood of the descendants of Ahab, right? But because he was also a descendant of Jehoshaphat, jumping Jehoshaphat, that's how I remember that, they buried him. They gave him a proper burial because he wasn't to be shamed. And so, but this just kind of shows you the difference in respect between these two people. And then verse 10, this is where it gets really interesting. Now when Athaliah, the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she arose and destroyed all the royal heirs of the house of Judah. So well, what does the grandma do? She finds out, you know, her husband's been killed. Now her son has been killed. Now, so what does she do? She goes down to the nursery and kills all the babies. This is a bad grandma. It seems like there's a lot of bad grandmas in this family. Have you noticed that? It's like this lady is one sick grandma. But it shows the depravity of the family. A family had no care for the sanctity of life. They'd burned their children to Molech. When they found Ahab's palace in Samaria, they excavated it. What they found all around the palace was jars filled with bones of babies, because they would take the babies and burn them to Molech, and they, you know, sacrifice to a god. And the whole idea was power. You know, if I burn this baby to Molech, I receive the power of that child upon my life. And it's, you know, it was just a sick, idolatrous worship. But this is the way this woman thought. I'm going to go and take the power from all these babies. That's probably why she's killed all of them. Verse 11, but Jehoshabeth, the daughter of the king, so this is the daughter of, and you know, it's difficult because there's no word for granddaughter. This could have been the sister of, the aunt, which it probably was, probably speaking of Jehoshaphat's daughter. The daughter of the king took Joash, the son of Ahaziah, and stole him away from among the king's sons who were being murdered, and put him and his nurse in a bedroom. So Jehoshaphat, the daughter of the king of Jehoram, the wife of Jehoiada, the priest, for she was the sister of Ahaziah. So she was actually Asa's, She was Jehoshaphat's daughter. Hid him from Athaliah so that she did not kill him. And he was hidden with them in the house of God for 6 years while Athaliah reigned over the land. Could you imagine what this would have been like, being in a land where this woman, the wicked witch, is ruling? I mean, we almost experienced that. Oh, did I just say that? Just kidding. I know, that's horrible. I can't believe I'm on Facebook Live. Darn, I shouldn't. As true as we might think that is. But, you know, it's interesting because years later, this is what Isaiah the prophet would say. He'd say, "For Jerusalem stumbled and Judah is fallen because their tongue and their doings are against the Lord to provoke the eyes of his glory. The look on their countenance witness against them, and they declare their sin as Sodom, and they do not hide it. Woe to their soul, for they have brought evil upon themselves. Say to the righteous that it shall be well with them, for they shall eat the fruit of their doings. Woe to the wicked, it shall be ill for them, for the reward of his hand shall be given to him." This is the reward of God's hand. This is the woe that comes upon them. As for my people, children are their oppressors, and women rule over them, O my people. Those who lead you cause you to err and destroy the way of your paths. And this is exactly where they're at. You know, they did all this wickedness, and the only one who would step up to take the leadership was this wicked woman. And then it's going to end up being a child's ruling over them. You know, I mean, it's the fruit of their own folly. Verse 1. It says, "In the 17th year of Jehoiada, the high priest, strengthened himself." He found some strength within himself to stand up, and for a good reason, "and made a covenant with the captains of hundreds, Azariah the son of Jehoram, Ishmael the son of Jehohanan, Azariah the son of Obed, Maaseiah the son of Adoniah, and Elishaphat, the son of Zikri." I wish we just used these same names today. It would make it so much easier. "And then they went through Judea and gathered the Levites from all the cities of Judah and the chief fathers of Israel, and they came to Jerusalem." So what he's doing is he's starting to form a coup. He's gathering these people together. He's been secretly raising this child. Everybody thinks, and this is the interesting thing about all of Israel, you know, the Levites, everyone who's living in Israel thinks the word of God failed. That there's no child left. There's no heir left. They were all killed. Athaliah killed all of them. Now she's ruling. David's line has stopped. It's over. And everybody was led to believe that God's word had failed. But inside the temple, hiding out, was this little baby growing. He was just 1 year old when he was taken into hiding by the high priest's wife. And for 6 years, they allowed him to grow, keeping him in secret, waiting for the right moment for the unveil. Verse 3, "Then all the assembly made a covenant with the king of the house of God, and he said to them, 'Behold, the king's son shall reign, as the Lord has said, of the sons of David.'" So he gets all these trusted men, he unveils to them, there's going to be the king, a son of David is going to be king. And it says, verse 4, "This is what you shall do. One third of you shall enter, you entering on the Sabbath of the priests and of the Levites shall keep watch over the doors. One third shall be at the king's house and one third at the gate of the fountain. All the people shall be in the courts of the house of the Lord. But let no one come into the house of the Lord except the priests and those of the Levites who serve. They may go in, for they are holy, but all the people shall keep the watch of the Lord. And the Levites shall surround the king on all sides, every man with his weapons in his hands, and whoever comes into the house of the Lord, let him be put to death. You are to be with the king when he comes in and when he goes out." So this is tricky. They're trying to plan this whole thing up until this point. people have not respected the rules of the of God's house. And so he pulls all these Levites in and he starts to instruct them. He basically makes the Levites the personal bodyguards of tell him I'm busy. makes the Levites the personal bodyguards of Joash, this king, and basically sets instructions that nobody's allowed to come in except for those who are Levites. Verse 8, it says, so the Levites and all Judah did according to all that Jehoiada the priest commanded, and each man took his men who were to be on duty on the Sabbath with those who were going off duty on the Sabbath. For Jehoiada the priest had not dismissed the divisions. And so he calls everybody in. There's 24 courses. In 1 Chronicles chapter 24, he sets 24 courses of priests. Each one would serve for a month. And so basically every 2 years you would have a month as the priests, as those who are of the sons of Aaron, who would serve, and then Levites who would serve with you alongside you. And so he called all of them in, and he didn't let any of them go home. Everybody was on duty. It was all hands on deck. Everybody's there so they could protect this child. And they're going to become the personal bodyguards of this baby. So verse 9, it says, then Jehoiada the priest gave to the captains of hundreds the spears and large and small shields which had belonged to King David that were in the temple of God. So these are some of the things that David had set aside and stored in the temple of God. Then he set all the people, every man with his weapon in his hands, from the right side of the temple to the left side of the temple, along by the altar and by the temple, all around the king. And they brought out the king's son, put the crown on him, gave him the testimony, and made him king. Then Jehoiada and his sons anointed him and said, long live the king. And so this must have been quite the scene. Completely surrounded the entire temple with guards, armed Levites inside, everybody's ready. They bring the king out, this big unveiling. They put a crown on his head. He's just 7 years old. Can you imagine if you have a seven-year-old, what that would be like? Okay, this is going to be the king. He's going to be in charge. Put a crown on his head, put the Bible in his hand. That's what it means by the testimony. They put a Bible in his hand, and then they anointed him, you know, basically poured oil over his head, say declaring he's the king, and that would be what the high priest would do. And so now this kid is the king, and they're proclaiming that. And this would have brought this shouts out, long live the king. Then verse 12, it says, now when Athaliah heard the noise of the people running and praising the king, she came to the people in the temple of the Lord. That's what they were preparing for. Grandma's going to be on a rampage. You know, she's going to be upset about this thing. Verse 13, and when she looked, there was the king standing by his pillar at the entrance, and the leaders of the trumpeters were by the king, and all the people of the land were rejoicing and blowing trumpets, also the singers with musical instruments and those who led in praise. So Athaliah tore her clothes and said, treason, treason. Really? I mean, this is like a kid who murdered both of his parents to throw himself on the mercy of the court as an orphan or something like that. I mean, it's just like so ridiculous. Verse 14, so Jehoiada the priest brought out the captains of hundreds who were set over the army and said to them, take her outside under guard and slay her with the sword, whoever follows her. For the priest had said, do not kill her in the house of the Lord. So they seized her, and she went by the way of the entrance of the horse gate into the king's house, and they killed her there. And this is part of the prophecy of Ahab, that he would die and that his, you know, that their blood would be on the ground. And it's the same thing happens to his daughter here. First the dogs ate her mother, now she's going to be killed. Her blood's going to be spilled on the ground. And this would be the end of the wicked reign of Ahab. She'd be the last one of Ahab's house. Of course, her son's not going to be raised by them or counseled by them. This one that would be made king, this grandson of hers. But this would be the end of Rahab. In verse 26, it says, then Jehoiada made a covenant between himself and the people and the king that they should be the Lord's people. And all the people went to the temple of Baal and tore it down and broke it in pieces, its altars and images, and killed Matanan, I can't say that word, the priest of Baal before the altars. And of course, Joash, you know, just a 7-year-old lad, you know, he's not going to be making these decisions. And so these reforms are coming from Jehoiada, however you say his name, Jehoiada, the high priest. And this guy, by God's grace, is going to live a very, he was already old at this point, but he's going to live a very, very long time, far into the reign of Joash, who's going to follow the Lord as long as Jehoiada is alive. And so he's the one who's making these reforms, and he's the one who's turning the people back to the Lord, but he's also the one who's kind of pulling the strings of this king, who's just a child at this time. And it says, also Jehoiada appointed the oversight of the house of the Lord to the hand of the priests, the Levites, whom David had assigned to the house, in the house of the Lord, to offer burnt offerings of the Lord, as it is written in the law of Moses, with rejoicing and with singing, as it is, was established by David. And he set the gatekeepers at the gates of the house of the Lord so that no one who was in any way unclean should enter. And even remember back in 1 Chronicles, it talked about this. You know, David setting up the course of priests, and David setting up those who would sing, He-Man and all the singers, and all the people who would, in order, worship the Lord and facilitate that worship of the Lord. You know, God is very into doing things decently and in order. And that's how David had set it up. And so when these bad kings come in, everything just gets kind of messy and everything gets kind of sideways. And so reestablishing this worship, reestablishing all these things so that God can be honored in Israel again. Verse 20, it says, then he took the captains of hundreds, the nobles, the governors of the people, and all the people of the land, and brought the king down from the house of the Lord, and they went through the upper gate to the king's house and set the king on the throne of the kingdom. And so, you know, we have to realize, so now it's been 15 years. That's how long it's been since they've been under good reign. And you can imagine how excited anybody over probably the age of 25 is that this is all changed, you know, that this is back in order. And so people are very on board with this, and even though they have a 7-year-old ruling the kingdom. But, you know, I mean, I just, you know, I read these stories, and I hope that you, I hope that it produces some hope in your heart, you know, about our own country and about our own situation. And, you know, I mean, just to think of what it could be like and how it is actually in so many places around the world. I mean, we are so blessed in our nation to have the freedoms and to have the things, you know, set up the way that they are, you know, and that could be all taken away from us very easily. But man, we have been blessed so far, you know, and so continue to pray for our country. But it says, verse 21, so all the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was quiet, for they had slain Athaliah with the sword. In the Hebrew, this literally reads, ding dong, the witch is dead, the wicked witch. Just kidding. It doesn't really, but that's pretty much what this is all about. You know, I mean, this is a bad time. Could you imagine? All the munchkins dancing around, you know. Follow the yellow brick road, you know. No, it is. It's just amazing to me to look at this and to see what these people went through because somebody didn't want to follow the Lord. You know, that I guess the solution to us is to not allow the ungodly counsel, not allow the voices that are calling us to something else, the opportunity of, you know, when you see people looking at this pie-in-the-sky idea of, oh, this is going to be better if you come over here, if you follow this path, or if you do this, or if you join up with us. You know, none of those things, you know, satisfy. You know, life doesn't have anything to offer us that's satisfying. Do you realize that? You know, we have all these dreams and ambitions and hopes, and we're thinking, oh, if we just had this, or if we just had that, or if we just were able to go on this vacation, or if we just able to do this, then life would be satisfying. But, you know, the only thing that satisfies is the Lord. Nothing else satisfies. You know, and no matter how much you think, you know, if things were just different, you know, then I would be happy. It's not true. What makes people happy is their submission to the Lord, following him with all their heart, seeking his face, turning from their wickedness, asking God to lead them and guide them and to have his way in their life. And that's what really brings satisfaction. Everything else is empty. And you're never going to enjoy anything until you enjoy Jesus first. Then, once you do, everything has meaning. Everything becomes enjoyable. So, good lesson and now I hope you all feel better about the family you grew up in after reading about those guys. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. We thank you for this time together just to study through this and a lot of chapters and just a lot of drama there. But Lord, we're just grateful for these things that can help us to grow and learn and just to be more effective for your kingdom. I pray, Father, that you would help us to learn from these lessons, that we would not repeat them. Give us grace. Help us to seek you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.